good afternoon to all of you. I will try to keep, we moved, as you know, we moved the presentation that was meant to be this morning to this afternoon. So I will speak for a couple of hours, 2 hours and a half, you see, how fast I can go. So I'll try to go fast. In case you don't understand something, just raise your hand and ask question. I will try to be less theoretical and less boring as possible, and to finish quickly to let you pass to the second part of this course, which is the most important one, the part where you actually put your hands on the tool that I will show you this afternoon. Because this course is not that much meant to teach you about the theory of innovation or the theory of technology, but to make you play with a few tools that I will introduce soon that can be used, among many other things, to study innovation and technology. But before moving to the tools, which I hope I will do as soon as possible, just a very quick theoretical introduction to explain you why we are teaching you this kind of tool and how you have to use them, in which conceptual framework you have to use them. I will start by a short video. That probably some of you know. We will play a little game. So the first one who recognized the movie win. Okay. Yeah. Very famous. And very interesting. So this is, as you know, as all of you, half of you at least, recognize the first scene of 2001 Space Odyssey, which is called The Dawn of a Man. And as probably most of you remember, what happens is that humankind has not yet evolved. There are only apes, gorillas. And then, suddenly, from somewhere in the space, this black thing, this black monolith, appear among the apes. And the apes are first of all surprised, they don't know what it is, and then they come closer and closer. They touch, they start using in a minute, they start touching this black monolith, and so they enter in contact with technology. And the second scene that I will not show you today, which is the scene that actually follows this one, shows one ape that after having entered into contact with this alien technology, understand the meaning of technology and innovation, and he actually used a bones to crack other pieces of bones. And he actually invents the first tool. He actually makes the first innovation. Because it's a mythical account of what innovation is, but also an account that is very far from what innovation actually is. So let me get back to my presentation. In the account, in the description, in the conception that 2001 Space Odyssey and Kubrick, Stanley Kubrick, gave us of innovation, innovation is something that arrives from the outer space, that appears among the apes or the humans, and that it's a sort of black box. The apes did not invent this black thing, this black monolith. They've done nothing to deserve this technology. It just arrives among them, and then they have to understand how to use it. They don't know at all what's happening, what's going on inside. It's never revealed in the movie. Later on in the movie, it said that it's probably a communication device, but no one knows exactly. And still, it has an effect. It affects the life of these apes, and in fact, it transforms the apes into men. So this is a very bad conception of innovation. One that I would like to, in the half an hour, three quarter of hour that I will use for a theoretical introduction, this is a conception of innovation that I would like to overcome. And it's not just something that is presented in this movie. It's something that is very deeply rooted in our culture. The idea that technology and innovation are black box. The technical term in the sociology of science and technology for this is black boxing. The idea is that the idea that technology is created elsewhere, into companies, into laboratories, into research and development units, so in a place that is somewhat hidden from the view of the population. And then it arrives on the market, it arrives on the population, and it is like a black box. You are not able to open it, you don't know what's going on inside, but you just use it. And probably most of you have remarked the striking resemblance with another black box, very famous one, whose design of which was in fact inspired by 2001 Space Odyssey, the iPhone and the iPad, of course, which are a black monolith like the one that we see in 2001 Space Odyssey. Apple made a huge effort to deliver the technology they deliver as black box. You don't have to understand what's going on inside. You cannot understand what's going on inside. In fact, Apple, this is true for computer as well. If you, it's impossible to open an Apple computer. It's very difficult. The very screws that they use in their technology are different from the standard one, precisely because they don't want people to open the technology and look what's inside, which is true at the hardware level, but it's also true at the software level. You know, there was a huge controversy about the iPhone, iPad operating system and the fact that the developer doesn't know how it actually works because it's hidden by Apple. And the idea is that the design, the interface is so easy that you don't have to understand what's going on inside, and you are prevented, in fact, from knowing it. It's just a simple object, autonomous. You don't have to understand what's going on inside. In fact, you can forget that there is an inside. You just look at the outside. You just use the black box. But then, of course, you all know that things are much more complex, that even if the interface seems simple, the iPhone and the iPad are a very complex technology. And here, for example, there's a couple of engineers that enjoy themselves in cracking open an iPhone and then remounting it without much success. Because once it's open, it's screwed, which is not true for many other technology, but precisely one of the, it has been made that way so that people doesn't open it. And you have the, if you want to see, you have the URL of the page where they explain how to open up your own iPhone, in case you want. But be aware that you will not be able to close it again. So we all know that technology is not something that arises from the outer space. It's not created by aliens that would send technology to the Earth. We all know that technology has an inside, but we tend to forget it because, and that's precisely the meaning of black boxing a technology, when innovation works, when technology works, not only is obsolete, like Massimiliano was saying this morning, but it also became a black box. It became an interface without an internal, without an inside. Of course, you know that there is an inside, you know that things are much more complex, but you tend to forget about them. But let me give you another example. Another technology, the shuttle. In fact, this is the Columbia shuttle, which is another technology we tend to consider as a closed black box. As soon, as long as it works, you don't know to understand exactly what's going on inside and how the millions of parts that constitutes this technology are connecting one to the other. You start asking questions about this only when the technology explodes. So this is the Challenger disaster in 1986, when a few seconds after the launch, the Challenger shuttle exploded in the air, killing the sixth member of the crew, if I'm not wrong. And then, of course, after this disaster, the technology was open. And then a commission was formed to study why the causes of this disaster. then what they did, this is the Roger Commission, they gathered all the pieces of the shuttle to study what went wrong. In fact, this image is the Columbia shuttle. It's another shuttle that exploded in the air. It's not the Challenger, the one I will talk about. But I didn't find an image of the Challenger. But more or less what they did is the same. Collect all the parts that were scattered around many, many, many square kilometers, put them in a hangar, and study all the different connections to see what went wrong. And what went wrong was this. This little piece of plastic, this little ring of plastic, this size, something like that, that cracked and then was destroyed at the moment of the launch. The meaning of this, the function of this little plastic ring is to separate two part of the shuttle to avoid that the fuel leaks from one part to the other part of the shuttle. And the reason why it failed is that because when it is exposed to low temperature, the plastic loses its elastic properties, and so it can break. As it has been shown by one of the members of the commission, the Roger Commission, Richard Feynman, the famous mathematician and physician, US mathematician and physician, who on US television showed that if you immerse in ice water a little ring like the one that was in the shuttle, it loses all its flexibility and it can break. You can break it easily with a little torsion, which is precisely what happened. So the question that many people looking at TV asked was, are the NASA engineers all idiots? I mean, anyone knows that plastic, when it's cold, can break, loses its elastic properties and can break. So why did they launch? Why did they decide to launch the shuttle, even if they knew that it was the specific morning was particularly, which was in April, was particularly cold? And the reason, which has been shown by an important book by Diane Vaughan called The Challenger Launch Decision, the reason of this failure was not just the failure of the little plastic ring, but also a failure in the NASA organization. What Diane Vaughan studying NASA and the reports of the Roger Commission find out was that, in fact, this kind of little plastic rings had break many times in the previous launch of the shuttle. But none of the previous time, this had important issues or consequences on the launch itself. So launch after launch, people in NASA, in the NASA organization, became kind of accustomed to the fact that this thing can break. They knew that it could be dangerous. They knew that it could be very dangerous. Still, they sort of start living with the risk. Because after all, they launched the shuttle 10 times. The ring probably broke 10 times, but no major consequence happened. So why not launch it an 11th time? And this is what Diane Vaughan calls normalization of deviance. You start to accept as normal something that should not be accepted as normal. But what is important for us today is to understand that in a complex technology like the shuttle that looks like a black box when you look at it from the outside, is in fact composed by a plurality of different elements. And for the shuttle to work, every little element, from the bigger one to the small plastic ring, have to keep together. If the connection, if one of the connection between one couple, whatever couple of elements is broken for whatever reason, and then the technology doesn't work, and you also can have disastrous consequences. But what is also interesting in this example, and what Diane Vaughan shows, it is not just technological parts, that technological objects are not just composed by technological parts, components, because the NASA organization itself was an important part of the shuttle. The construction of this black box is not just made of technical components, technical subparts. It is also made by the human relation, the social relations that exist among the people that works or that makes a technology work. In the sociology of science and technology, this principle has a name, and it's called the symmetry principle. The idea that science and technology are social construction. In this little sentence is the first part of this slide. In this little sentence, there are two things that you have to keep in mind. First of all, the science and technology are constructions. So they are built, they are constructed by someone. They do not just arrive from outer space, like the black monolith in 2001 Space Odyssey, but they are in fact built by the work of an heterogeneous network of components. And the other important word in this little sentence is social. Technology are not just a technical question. Technologies are also a social question. And this is true as well for science. But then, and things gets even more complex, this principle has been invented by a British sociologist called David Bloor. But thing gets even more complex and interesting because someone else, in fact, Bruno Latour, my master, the professor I'm working with, transformed the symmetry principle and stated the generalized symmetry principle. And the generalized principle is simple, according to Bruno Latour, is that society is a techno-scientific construction. Not only technology is made of sociology, also society, but society is made of technology and science. And I'll give you some examples. The most well-known example is the bridges of New York. It's a very interesting example described by Landon Winner in a very interesting book called The Whale and the Nuclear Reactor. Where many others technical artifacts, it describes the bridges that cross the roads, the many different roads, that goes from New York to Long Island. These bridges were built by a very famous architect in the history of New York, of the architecture of New York, which is called Robert Moses, which built New York as we know it today, more or less, a big part of it. And Long Island was considered to be the garden of New York. Well, it was a very nice beach, very well designed, where people could go on weekends to spend some time in family, be happy. And the bridges that Robert Moses decided to build, that crosses the road that goes to Long Island, have a very particular feature. They're very low. They're only, I think, 2 meter and 2.30 meters, something like that. So buses cannot go under them. So if you wanted to go, of course, it has been changed today, but at the time of Robert Moses, if you wanted to go to Long Island, you had to have a car. You cannot take the public transportation to go to Long Island just because it was impossible to go by bus from New York to Long Island. And this was made. Of course, it's a little controversial why Robert Moses decided to take this decision, but according to some of these biographers, it was because it was racist, in fact. And he wanted only white people, rich people, to be able to arrive to get to Long Island. And he wanted that black people that used public transportation were excluded from this part of the city. So what is interesting is that a very strong racial segregation was obtained not by law, not by a segregation law, not by customs, not by a social element, but by a technological element, the bridge itself. Bridge built a bridge that is short, that is low enough, and you will prevent a part of the population to enjoy a part of the city. And this is something that we can observe countless times. the way our technology is built make a difference in the way our social relations can happen, can take place. For example, the fact that this room is made in a way that there is a small podium here, and that all the chairs are, for example, facing this direction, gives me, and also the fact that I have a microphone, gives me some sort of priority in the discourse that we are having. Of course, you can, you know, raise your hand, you are welcome to do so, and ask questions. But the relation that we have is asymmetrical, is strongly asymmetrical. And this is not, this is not just because you are students I am a teacher. It is because the very room where we are is made in a way that it materializes this asymmetrical relationship between me and you. So we can ask the question, what would it be? What would we be if we would remove all our technology? Just imagine that for some magical trick, all the technology that we have disappear in a minute. What would be out of humankind? We'll probably get back to be. We'll probably get back to be monkey. And in fact, there's nothing in our social life. There's nothing in the interpersonal relation that we have with other people, with your fellow students, with your colleagues, your teacher. There's nothing that is much different compared to the life of apes and monkeys and baboons and gorillas and so on and so forth. In fact, they have a social life that is very rich, that is as rich as the one of human beings. What they don't have is technology. And if you think of a very famous legend, which is the foundation myth of our society, which is the myth of Tarzan, or Jungle Book, you have Mowgli, which is exactly the same character, the kid that is raised by apes, wolf, whatever, by animals. There's always an important moment in the life of Tarzan, whatever version of Tarzan you read, films or books or whatever, where Tarzan discovers that he can build tools. So it's often a knife or a spear. But in the legend of Tarzan, this is often presented as an increase in the efficiency of the action of Tarzan. Because he has built his own knife, because he has built his own spear, Tarzan can hunt better than other apes. And so he becomes more powerful than the other apes, and he can fight against the tiger or whatever it was. But in fact, there's another important, and of course this is true, that technology allows human beings to change the relationship they have with their environment, with nature. The fact that we have a nice room with air conditioning allows us not to be, and close, of course, allows us not to be cold, just to sit and stay still for 2 hours, which would be impossible if you were naked and outside. Even if today is a nice day, so. But what is also very important is the way technological innovation change not just the relationship that we have with the environment, but the relationship that we have among ourselves. Let me give you another example. I said that the social life of baboons and gorillas, in this case, is a very rich one. And in fact, it's probably even richer than the one of human being. Because, for example, imagine to be the dominant, the alpha male in a gorilla group. Imagine that Costanzo is the alpha male of this group, like it is, in fact. What he could do is probably, you know, have the better part of bamboo, eat the better part of the nice food that was served at the restaurant, but he can't do much more than that. He can have more food than the other apes, the other gorilla, but a little more. Because for a very simple reason. It's very difficult to store food that is gathered or hunt. You can have the if you're a tiger, you can have the better part of the zebra, but you cannot store. It doesn't make sense to store 100 zebras in your cavern because they will rotten in a few days. Same is true for bamboos and stuff, fruits and stuff that you can gather in fish as well. But as soon as human beings discover agriculture, things change dramatically for a very simple reason. You can store seeds, and they last for a long time. And so you can start accumulating resources, seeds, for example. And you not only, first of all, the fact of having more seeds than other human beings was a consequence of your strength, of the fact that you were the strongest ape in the community. But then, time after time, it becomes not a consequence, but a cause. It is because you have more seeds that you are the dominant ape, that you are alpha male of the community. Your domination is in a way materialized in a technological object, a pile of seeds, for example. And so you don't have to rediscuss all the time. But I've said that baboons' life is very complex and very rich, and it is the case because they have to rediscuss all the time the social hierarchy. The male, the alpha male, or the alpha women, or the alpha female, is never alpha female all the time. It's never something that is not discussed anymore. It has to discuss and fight all the time to be able that its dominant position is conserved. But once you can transfer, materialize your dominant position in a pile of seeds, or in a castle, or in an army, or in a weapon that is stronger, that are more efficient than the one that the other have, your domination is somewhere does not rely on the fact of being rediscussed all the time. It relies on the fact of being materialized by a technology. And that is why many anthropologists think that the forms of the pyramid, that the pyramids are the same forms of the pile of seeds, because it is through piling seeds that the very idea of authority became possible. So what is very important for you as students in design, architecture, and engineer, is that anytime you are connecting to different pieces of material, to different materials, or to different technological components, you have to keep in mind that you are not just connecting to technical components, you're also having an effect on society. An effect that can be very, very important. Many examples were given this morning by Massimiliano, so I will not go into details. And so it is very important when you consider innovation and technology to be able to open the black box of technology and see what's inside, because this will have an important impact on social life, on the relationship we can have with nature, with our environment, but also with our fellow human beings. But this is difficult. And there is an important author and thinker in STS, whose name is Harry Collins, who proposed another metaphor, but which means the same thing as the black box that I presented you before. He says technologies and scientific theory, technological artifact and scientific theory, seems as sheep in the bottle. When you look at them, most of the time, you see them as you would see a sheep in a bottle, which is to say, already in the bottle. And since you don't know how the sheep was put inside the bottle, you would have the impression that the sheep have always been in the bottle, that the technology has always been efficient, for example, a given scientific theory has always been true, and you would forget easily the work that is necessary to construct, to build this technology or this scientific theory. Technological artifact and scientific theory, this is what I'm trying to show you, exist and works only because they are constructed by the work of many different actors, and not just social actors, but also technological actors. So every technological artifacts, as well as every scientific theory, is an heterogeneous network composed of human and non-human actors. But the question that you may ask is, how can we observe this construction? If most of the times what we see is the ship already in the battle, how can we see how the ship is built inside the battle? Well, the first possibility is to break the battle and look what is inside, which is precisely what happened with the Challenger shuttle. The Challenger exploded, so it broke in thousands of pieces. And so now we have the opportunity to look at the pieces and to see how they were connecting one to the other. But of course, most of the time, shuttle, luckily, of course, right, most of the time, shuttle do not explode. So how can we study this process of social construction of technology or technological construction of society? And the reason is, and the answer is, by looking at the moments where the people that are constructing this technology talk about their construction process. For example, this is an image that I found on the internet that shows how you build a battle in a ship in a battle. And the way you build it is you build the ship outside the battle. In case you are interested, this is the way it works. You build the ship inside the battle, then you enter the ship in the battle. The tree is still is not mounted. And then you have a little, probably you cannot see, there's a little thread that goes from the tree to the outside of the battle that you use to remount the tree and the sails. And this is one of the way that you build ship in the battle. The problem is that when technology works, the people that construct technology doesn't speak about it. They just build it without necessarily verbalize what they do. But they do verbalize if there is a controversy. That is why controversies play such an important role in the study of science and technology. For example, this image, I was able to find it because there's a huge controversy on ship in the battle. Because this is one of the techniques, but this is another one, which consists in building the whole ship inside the battle using very long tools. And there's a very huge and very violent for people that does ship in the battle. They're not exactly hooligans, but still, they discuss a lot about that, the one accusing the other of doing it wrong. And precisely because they are accusing each other and justifying each other, that is why I could find this image and a long explanation of how you build a ship in the battle. So when you want to know how a technology works, look for the controversy. And within controversy, people will be talking explicitly about the technique, the construction technique that they use. Let me give you another example. A very important one, at least for me, because I'm working on this topic, climate change. For example, you probably know that a few days before the Copenhagen conference, which was a very important conference because it was meant to find an alternative to the Kyoto Protocol that, as you know, will expire next year. A few days before the Copenhagen conference, a group of hackers hacked into the computer of the East Anglia Climate Unit, which is a very important British climatology unit, and they stole all the email that was stored on the server of the East Anglia Climate Unit, and then they public diffused all the mail of the East Anglia Unit on the internet. And many climate skeptics skimmed through the email and found it quotations that could be used, according to them, to prove, and I will show you some of them before in a moment. And they used them to prove that there was in fact in sort of conspiracy among the climatologists to make us believe that climate change was going on, but in fact it was not the case. This was very sad for the Copenhagen conference, because this is also, of course, there are many different reasons for the failure. You know, the Copenhagen conference was a complete failure. So no agreement was found to replace the Kyoto Protocol, and yet there's no agreement to replace the Kyoto Protocol. And in part, it is also due to the ClimateGate scandal. But it was a very good news for sociologists, because now we can access to this beautiful corpus of text, the email exchange by the Islandia unit, which is, you know, the most important climate unit in Europe, so one of the most important in the world. And we can actually see how the very discipline of climatology was constructed in the last few years. And I don't know if because it's a little expensive in broadband, let's see if we can able to see the video. This is a very nice video that has been produced by a group of students in Chicago. Not sure that we have enough band to see it. Let me see if it's the case. Where you see a graph, a dynamical animation, a network, in fact, a graph of all the email that has been exchanged among the climatology of the East Anglia units and other climatology. Each point here is an email address, and each link is an email being exchanged between two different email addresses. And what you're actually seeing, it's a little difficult to interpret just by looking at the video, but of course the researchers that produced this video also produced the explanation, the interpretation that goes with it. What you are seeing is the climatology being formed, being constructed under your eyes, starting from 1998, something like that, 1997, up to 2007. It stopped because we don't have enough broadband, but you can look at it on the internet, it'll give you the address. But what is also very interesting is that not only we can see, and this is the final frame of the video, not only we can see the dynamic, they have the big picture of the building of the climatology as a discipline, as an international discipline, but we can also zoom in and read the specific quotations of the text that were presented in the email. And these are the three quotations that are the most quoted by media and by climate skeptics, where you can read, "I've just completed Mike's statue trick of adding the real temperature to each series to hide the decline in temperature. And then I think we have to stop considering climate research as a legitimate peer-reviewed journal. Perhaps we should encourage our colleagues in the climate research community to no longer submit or cite paper in this journal." And I can see either of these paper being in the next IPCC. The IPCC, you know, is the International Panel on Climate Change. IPCC report, Kevin and I will keep them out somehow, even if we have to redefine what peer review is. And the climate skeptic, of course, cried to the scandal and said, "See, they are using tricks to hide the temperature decline. They are agreeing not to publish in a review, so to kill a review, just because it accepted to publish a couple of climatometric papers." And they arrive, the climatologist arrives, even to redefining the sacred institution of peer review to leave out climatoskeptics' point of view from the IPCC report. But of course, if this, there's no scandal, there's really no scandal about these phrases, this quotation. If some of you is shocked by this phrase, is only, and if most of the public opinion was shocked by these phrases, is only because we have a bad view of what science is. We think that science and technology are completely separated from society, and that social interaction, social processes have no role, or should have no role, which is even worse, in science and technology. In fact, there's nothing, this is, in all these sentences are just describing the normal way in which science and technology is carried out. the first sentence, it is very clear. If you have data that you want to show in a scientific paper, you have to decide how to show them. And it's completely normal to choose one visualization or the other according to the one that proves the point that you want to make in the article that you are writing. This happens all the time because, of course, there are many different ways to present data. And every scientist, climate skeptics or climatologists or whatever, in whatever discipline, decide to use the representation that best suits its aim, the objective of this paper. Second phrase, if scientists spend half of their time discussing on how to present data and producing data and discussing how to produce data, they spend the other half of their time discussing about in which review they will publish. Because of course, you know, it's very important. It has a huge impact on your scientific career. And so scientists spend most of their half of their time at least discussing, should we publish in this review, should we not? Should we defer this other review? It has a better impact factor. It's a review that is rising, that will be very famous in the next few years, and so on and so forth. But there's nothing strange, there's nothing scandalous about that. And for the last phrase, there's nothing, once again, there's nothing strange, there's nothing weird, nothing scandalous about discussing what peer review is or should be. Because in fact, peer review changes all the time. There's not such a thing as peer review. There are many different techniques of peer review that are discussed and built differently according to the discipline, to the reviews. Different disciplines have completely different techniques of peer review. And sometimes even different review, different journal within the same discipline has different techniques of peer review. So there's nothing bad in talking about that. The good thing, the good news for us as sociologists of science and technology is that controversies are everywhere. So when I said to you, if you want to know how technology and science is constructed, look at the controversy, look at the disputes. The good news is disputes are everywhere. It will not be that difficult to find a dispute to study. And even in your own project, in the subject you will study in your own project, look for controversy, look for disputes, look for debates, because it is where you will find information about the thing you are studying. Take whatever technological issue that is troubling our society, that is important in our society. Energy production, you have controversy. Industrial manufacturing, you have a huge controversy. Biotechnology, huge controversy. Nanotechnology, huge controversy. The technology doesn't even exist yet. And still, there's an enormous amount of controversy about nanotechnology. Global warming, of course. Biodiversity. So it's not just technology, it's also natural sciences. And of course, also social sciences itself. They are not free from controversy. Take economics, for example, sociology, many others. Take, for example, all the controversy about how do we exit the crisis. There's a huge debate about that. That is very useful for sociologists of technology, or just for people that are interested in looking at how technology is constructed. But there's a downside, there's a disadvantage in controversy, which is that the advantage is of course that they allow us to study, to look, to open the black box of science and technology and look what's inside. But the bad things, the disadvantage about controversy is that if you don't handle them right, they can create huge problems. And it's impossible to handle them right if we don't conceptualize them right. So if we start, for example, from a simplest and wrong conception of what is the role of science in society, let's say that we believe what Stanley Kubrick wanted to make us believe, that science and technology are some sort of, you know, autonomous elements, and that society is a sort of context around them. But yes, science and technology would be a sort of inner core, and then all around this inner core, there would be society, which would be a sort of context of science and technology. This is a very typical way of thinking to the relationship between science and technology. I think that probably most of you, how many of you would subscribe this vision of science and technology? No one? You think it's someplace? What would you criticize about this? Yeah? The different society, the answer was very good answer. Different society push technology in different directions, so we should have not just one society and one technology, but many society and many technology, if I understand right your suggestion. What else? This is correct, but there are many other problems with this image. For people that can't see the image, it's very simple. It's a black circle that represents science and technology, and the social context, that gray circle, that's around.
There is no an arrow from the technology, from the core to the society.
Right, this is another good observation. There's an arrow that goes from society to science and technology. So society is affecting science and technology, but we don't see the other arrow. And I tried to explain to you why it is so important to consider the effect, the consequences that adopting a certain technology has on society. So this is a good point. Something else? Yeah. Yeah. Scientists are not outside society. They're not, there's no, and this is probably the most important critiques that we can make to this image, there's no barrier. Look as long as you want, you will not find a clear barrier between science and society, between technology and society. Consider whatever discipline, consider whatever technological object, it is very easy to show that either it is affected by society or it affects society. And also, start deploying the networks that construct a technology, you will always find many actions of many different types. So try to look at a social network, you will always find, and not just online, whatever social network, and you will see that it's made possible by technology. Think about your own group of friends. If you had no mobile phones, it would be much more difficult to keep up the relation with you. Probably your group of friends would be smaller. And it is why human society are much bigger than, for example, monkey society. But the other way is also opposite. Try to understand why the shuttle Challenger explode, and you will stumble on some organizational feature of NASA, of a social organization. So there's no separation between science and society. They are not two different things. There only are different networks that connect elements of different type. But if we start from this wrong conception of the role of science in society, we will also have a wrong conception of controversy, because we will imagine that if science and technology were left to themselves, they will arrive straightforwardly to the truth or to the technological efficiency. And that society, some way, is always a bad influence on science and technology. It diverts, it hijacks the trajectory, the straight trajectory of science and society, of science and technology, because of social influences. And so then we have to arrive to the truth or to the efficiency through the path of controversy. That if we could separate science and technology from society, from social influence, we could arrive straightforwardly, directly, to truth and technical efficiency. Of course, this is not the case. It is because, as I've tried to show you, technology works precisely because there are contributions for society. And society works only because there are contributions for technology. But if you have this wrong idea of scientific controversy, then you will have a wrong idea of the relationship between science and politics. Because you would imagine, and this is not a very common way of thinking of the relationship between science and politics, you would imagine that whenever a scientific issues is posed, like, for example, climate change is the is the climate changing, how fast and why. So we have to take political decision if you want to stop it. So the classical way of thinking the relationship between science and politics would be the politic ask question to the scientists. Then the scientists are left alone in their ivory towers, as separated as they can from political influences. They came up with their theory, with their decision, and once they came up, when they all agree on a theory, they provide the answer to the policymaker, who in turn will take decision on the issue. But of course, as you know, it doesn't work. It'll never work. A relationship like this one will never work. It has never worked, and it will never work for at least two reasons. For the first reason is that, of course, there's no separation between the two, because, for example, if you want science to find results, you have to found science, you have to pay for the experiment, you have to pay for the laboratory, it costs a lot, and it's a political decision, at least for public research, to choose which research line are financed and which are not. So even in the very choice of the thing that you will study, there's a political influence, but there's nothing wrong about that. But it is just that you cannot separate the two, or at least that it's very difficult. But there's also another, probably most important reason why this solution is impossible. Do you have some idea? Does someone of you can think of a reason why this relationship between science and technology cannot work, between science and politics cannot work? Yeah, scientists have political ideas, so their reports, the answer they will give are not unbiased, which is of course true, but there's something else.
There are controversies in the science field.
Exactly. There are controversies in the science field. Scientists do not agree. And if we leave them enough time, they will probably come to an agreement. Let's say that we give economists, oh, let's say we give climatologists 50, 60, 70 years, and they will probably agree in details on climate change is taking place. They already agree on that. Well, there's a complete agreement on that. But they will also agree on which are the causes and how we can fight against it. And then we could take a political decision that is based on sound scientific basis, except that if we wait 50 or 70 years before we take measure against climate change, we will be dead. We cannot wait so long. We cannot wait for scientists to agree before we take a decision. And this is precisely the meaning of the precautionary, a principle that you probably heard of. It's the precautionary principle. The precautionary principle is not at all what is shown in this cartoon. This is a wrong interpretation of the precautionary principle, as if the precautionary principle was a sort of obstacle to action. Like, you don't know exactly which are the consequences of something, so you don't do it. Scientists do not agree on something, so we don't do it. This is a completely wrong interpretation of the precautionary principle, one that is based on the wrong idea of the relationship between science and society, science and politics, and so forth. In fact, if you go read the actual definition of this precautionary principle, it is stated in the 15th principle of the Rio Declaration on Environment and Development. It reads, where there are threats of serious or irreversible damage, lack of full scientific certainty shall not be used as a reason for postponing cost-effective measure to prevent environmental degradation, which is exactly the opposite. Even if we are not sure, even if there are controversy about something, we still have to take measure if there are risks for the environment. So it is precisely not an obstacle to action. It is, on the contrary, a principle that encourages policymakers to act even if full scientific consensus is not reached, precisely because it takes a lot of time to reach consensus. And on all the things that matters to our society today, scientists are still debating. We cannot wait most of the time. We cannot wait them to agree. But then you could ask, OK, but who is to take this decision? Who is to take the decision of what we do? Not scientists, because they do not agree. So different scientists would take different decisions. Another possibility would be the policymaker themselves. This is, for example, the solution that was suggested by Kashmir in a famous book that is called Dear Dictator, where it says, in a, what it called a state of emergency, state of exception, sorry, it is the leader, the political leader, that have to take the responsibility for taking decision. When no one else can do it, when there is controversy and no one can decide in which direction we go, it is the leader, the political leader, that has to take the decision. But of course, the downside of this solution is that, as you know, it can lead to dictatorship. And in fact, it's exactly what happened. Kashmir was the theory of Kashmir was vastly used by the Third Reich in Germany. So if it's not, if it's neither the policymaker nor the scientist, who is to take the decision on these ideas? Who is to decide on controversy? Who is to decide on what we do for climate change, or industrial production, or atomic energy, or whatever? Who is to decide? No idea? Sorry? Composed by who? Okay, so this is a good answer. The answer is special organization, specialized organization built for this aim, which is in fact a solution that is often followed. Like this is why the IPCC was created, precisely for this reason. But the problem is that most of the time people in this organization do not agree. So they often have one report and one minority report. And so there's someone else to decide on which report we take. So it happened for IPCC. It happened for most of these organizations. So who is, if the organization, if it works, OK, it's a very good idea. And it's actually used most of the time. But most of the time, it doesn't work. So what happens if the, yeah?
Who is affected by the decision?
Yeah, so who? People. If you want to remain in a democratic state, the only possible answer is the public opinion. It is the public opinion that has to decide on this matter. And this was the solution that was given first by many men, but first of all by this man who's called Walter Lippmann, which is the father of the American journalism, who wrote a book that it's called The Phantom Public, in which he provided this answer. It is, if you want to stay in a democratic state, it is the public opinion that has to decide on scientific and political and societal controversy. But Walter Lippmann was a pragmatist thinker, which means that he was not imagined that people, then the public opinion, could do things that, in fact, he cannot do. And if you go read what it says, the quotation from the public, the Phantom Public, reads, "It is controversy of this kind, the hardest controversy to disentangle, that the public is called in to judge. Where the facts are the most obscure, where the present are lacking, where novelty and confusion pervade everything, the public, in all its unfitness, is compelled to make its most important decision." The key word in this sentence is, "In all is unfitness." So Walter Lippmann recognized that the public is unfit to take this decision, that it is inadequate. We are talking about the most we are talking about the hardest controversy to disentangle, where the facts are the most obscure, where precedents are lacking, where novelty, confusion, pervade everything. We are talking about stuff like the economical crisis, nanotechnology, biotechnology, whatever, the kind of thing that I mentioned before. These are very technical and difficult subject. It's not like, you know, tomorrow morning you wake up and you're able to read literature in climatologists and have in a half an hour an idea of what's going on, if it's really changing the climate or not, in which direction, who is to be blamed for this, and so on and so forth. And Walter Lippmann knows very well this, and he says he knows that the public opinion can dedicate to each issues, like climate change or biotechnology, only the little time that he has. This is exactly what he says in his book, the little time that he has between one stops on the metro and the next one, the tube, and the next one. So we cannot ask to the public, precisely because the public is not made of specialists, it's not made of experts, to have a very deep understanding of most scientific and technological questions. It will not. It doesn't have the time. It doesn't have the resources. It doesn't want to. And the public is right not to want to understand the details of the scientific question. He's not a scientist. He's doing other work. You want to know the details of the things you are working with, not of all the possible technological problems that exist in the world. There are too many. It would be impossible to know the details in all of them. And yet, in knowledge and fitness, it is the public, if you want to stay in a democratic state, that has to decide on this controversy. How? How do you think that this could be possible? Suggestions? Yes? So you're a pessimist? Okay. Walter Lippmann is optimist. Even if it's pragmatist, he thinks there is a solution. Yep. Referendum, yeah, or in general, voting. Yep.
Choosing the right person to take decision.
This is exactly what Walter Lippmann says, but which is this, it comes to the same. We are in a representative democracy, so we choose the right person. What he says is the public should align behind the ones that are less biased, the ones that are less partisan on each problem. But how do we know who is the right person to decide? How do we know who is the right person to vote, to take this decision? According to Walter Lippmann, this is precisely the function. Sorry, I don't have the slide. Doesn't matter. This is precisely the function of newspaper. Newspaper media, at this time, media were newspaper, at the time of Walter Lippmann. Radio already exists, but it was at this, or at the beginning. Newspaper, precisely the little article that you read in the little time that you spend from one stop of the metro to the other, should give you the little superficial view that is enough to help you to take an informed decision, even if not very informed, but still more than nothing, informed decision about the various issues. According to Walter Lippmann, media, and in particular newspaper, has to play this crucial role in democratic society. The problem, of course, is that, you know, newspapers are dying. In a few, in the United States, they are discussing if newspaper will survive 5 or 10 years. But no one would bet on the survival of newspaper in more than 10 years. And the reason is easy to explain. Newspaper are, the way newspapers are organized today is that newspapers are based on advertisement, you know, the price that you pay for your newspaper is nothing compared to what they the money that they gather with advertisement. So the work of journalists, professional journalists, is paid not by the price of the newspaper, it's paid by the advertisement. And newspaper, and with television and radio, until a few years ago, they had some sort of they have a monopoly of advertisement, which is they gather all the money coming from advertising, and they are losing this monopoly because of the arrival of electronic technology on the web, especially. And so they are able to find less and less money to pay for their journalists. This is why it is so important to try to find alternatives to traditional media and to newspaper, to find other ways to provide the public with the little element of information that they need to align behind the person who can make the right choice, as your colleagues said, or who is less biased, less partisan, as Walter Lindemann says.